If you've ever been in a science classroom, this is a pretty familiar sight. And since 2019 is the 150th anniversary of Mendeleev's initial organization of the periodic table and is the International Year of the Periodic Table, we're going to give you a little overview of what it is, what it's telling us, why it looks this way, and why it might be time for it to look a little different. Let's start with the very basics and work our way up. Every square represents an element. The smallest unit of an element is an atom of that substance, a substance that is incontrovertible. That means it cannot be chemically broken down into anything smaller. If you try to go smaller, you have to smash apart the atom and you'll get its subatomic particles, the protons, neutrons, and electrons. The letters in the middle of the square are the atomic symbol, and they indicate the element's name. Like this one, for example, O for oxygen. The number at the top of the square is the atomic number, which is the number of protons in the nucleus, and this is what defines which element it is. Oxygen's atomic number is 8, meaning it has 8 protons. Now, protons have a positive charge, while electrons have a negative charge, and since all of the elements on the periodic table have no charge, that must mean the number of protons in an element is equal to the number of electrons. In nature, however, elements are often reacting with each other and the world around them and may trade electrons around, becoming ionized, meaning they have charge. So atomic number is the number of protons in the element, which for neutral elements on the periodic table is also the number of electrons. And that brings us to the number at the bottom, which is atomic weight. You may notice that this number has digits after the decimal point, and that's because it's actually an average. Just how different ions of an element may have different numbers of electrons, isotopes of an element have different numbers of neutrons. They still have the same number of protons, otherwise it would be a totally different element. But different isotopes of that element have different numbers of neutrons, meaning each isotope has a different mass. And some isotopes are more common in nature than others, which means that each isotope is given a value according to how much of it exists, then they're all added together and divided by the total number of isotopes. That's what it means when we say that atomic weight is the weighted average mass of all of the different isotopes of that element. So that's all the information in each square. But why are they all arranged the way they are? The periodic table may look like a randomly assembled block of the extra Legos at the bottom of the bucket, but there's a distinct pattern at work here. In the same way that protons define an element's identity, electrons determine how the element interacts with the rest of the world, especially its outermost ring of electrons, called the valence electrons. When elements trade or share electrons, that's them bonding, forming molecules, becoming charged. Electron configuration determines how stable an element is, what its boiling point is, how likely it is to conduct electricity, and lots of other important information that we need to know when we want to make anything, from new plastics, to better medicines, to cleaning materials. Each column on the periodic table is called a group, or a family, numbered 1 through 18, and all the elements in a group have the same number of valence electrons, so they behave very similarly on a chemical level. That means if you know the electron configuration for each group, you can look at the periodic table and automatically have a lot of information about how that element behaves based on which group it's in. The rows of the periodic table are called periods, numbered 1 through 7, and the number of the period is equal to the number of rings it has filled with electrons. Potassium, for example, lives in the 4th period, which means it, along with the rest of the elements in that period, has 4 rings of electrons. When you combine that relationship between the rows and the periods, you get atoms that fill up their outer electron shell as you move to the right, starting over in the next level up when you come back to the first square on the left in the next period. The pattern repeats periodically, giving the periodic table its name. So it seems like the periodic table is a well-organized way of visualizing the elements of the universe based on their chemical composition. But some scientists say there's room for improvement. Notice this block here? It's a little bit of an add-on. The lanthanides and actinides are squeezed into 2 blocks here and then expanded into their own rows or periods down at the bottom of the table. Some scientists prefer to look at the relationships between the elements as a circle with rings or wedges dedicated to each group. This can sometimes feel like a more intuitive way to look at the repetitive nature of the element's properties. What do you think? Would you prefer to see a periodic circle in your classroom? Can you come up with a fun new way to look at all the different elements and their properties? Let us know down in the comments below and over on social. We're at Livermore Lab. And thanks for watching.